count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. Fail me now, you won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out.
Morning, church. I hope you're having a blessed day today. Today we are moving into provision and obedience, part number 25 today. We're going to continue talking about Elijah out of 1 Kings 17. We've been talking about this for 4 weeks now. We have 28 sermons on 1 Kings 17 so far, and we're going to keep going forward. Lord willing, this week we will go into the story of Zarephath. I've only been saying that for a week and a half now, but if the Lord will it, we will get to Zarephath. But before we do that, there's another truth that I want to talk about today. And today we're going to talk about the relentless pursuit of not quitting and the motivation of the heart to never draw back and to never quit. We've talked about this aspect of don't quit so many times. And today I'm going to give some testimony today. And I want to look at something that David talked about in a position of David's heart that was relentless. And when I say relentless, I mean he was not going to back down or back away or shy away from seeing his call and his purpose come to pass in his life. And we're going to look at one of the things that he was focused on doing for the Lord and walking out his purpose. And it was that the relentless pursuit of deciding not to quit in the face of whatever adversity came David's way. And we're going to talk about that today. So before we get started, I'm going to pray and then we're going to get right into it. So Father, I thank you. I pray you bless everybody under the sound of my voice. Let this word become wisdom, revelation, and the knowledge of your Son. Spiritual seed sown, producing in our body, mind, will, and emotion, transforming us by the renewing of our mind, conforming us to the image of Christ, growing us up in the measure and the stature of the fullness of Christ. God, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, what I want to talk about today, we've talked many times before on the aspect of don't quit. I preached a sermon on it. I've done daily teachings on it. Last summer, during our faith conference, 2022, if you remember that last Sunday service, I preached a sermon called Don't Quit. And when I preached that sermon, I was preaching two truths and a piece of hope. So this is something we even talked about yesterday in our Sunday service, was the two truths of 1 Kings 17 and Matthew 25, dealing with Elijah and the ravens and the parable of the talents. And then we know the piece of hope comes out of Genesis 3 into Revelation chapter 22. But today, I want to talk about this some more, about this relentless pursuit. I want to talk about how King David became resolved. He became settled. It wasn't just that I wasn't going to quit. And that's what I want to talk about today. So many people get focused on not quitting that they don't refocus into what they're going after. You know, you could, I talk about not quitting a lot, but I don't want you to just focus on, okay, I didn't give up today. But not only not giving up, it's not just not giving up. It's about being focused on purpose, that you know that there's something that you are supposed to do for the Lord. And that causes a driving force. And it's not just that you're not quitting and you're going after God, but that you have a relentless pursuit of the purpose and plan of God in your life, which causes you to be relentless about the fact you won't quit until you see the purpose of God come to pass in your life. And so many times this becomes one of the driving factors of the people that are great and the people that are, the people that are good and the people that are great at it. There's good men and women of God all through the body of Christ, and they are good. They teach the word of God. They don't quit. They endure through the tough seasons, and I commend them for being the people that don't quit, because so many people do quit when the going gets tough. You know, Dr. Summerall used to say, when the going gets tough, the tough get going. You know, it's when the time gets hard, when the pressures turn up, that you put your feet to the fire and you just start walking. You let the refiner's fire burn out the impurities inside of you, and you just move forward with God despite any of the adversity. That you're not willing to back down even in the face of death. That you won't quit. But you enduring to the end. You know, I'm not quitting, but it's like molasses flowing. It's just that sluggish trench going through, but there's no joy, there's no happiness, there's no purpose to go after to allow it to not be about just not quitting. You know, not quitting is a good thing. You need to be focused on perseverance, the ability to be sustained and the ability to keep going despite opposition. But you need to also be looking at this purpose of your life that allows you to have a target to go after, because then it's not about not quitting. Then it's about fulfilling the purpose of God in your life. And we're going to look at this today. So the first thing I want to do is I want to read through 1 Kings 17. We're going to read the first 10 verses as we've done every day. You should know this by heart. But it says, "And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, As the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, Get thee hence, and turn thee eastward, and hide thyself by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And it shall be that thou shalt drink of the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed thee there. So he went and did according unto the word of the Lord, for he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. And it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up, because there had been no rain in the land. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, Arise, get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. So he arose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow woman was there gathering of sticks. And he called to her and said, Fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. And then that leads into the story of Zarephath, which we've said literally every time we've read this story. But what I want to look at today, and let me give some backstory before we actually get to the passage I want to talk about today. And the passage I want to talk today is in Psalm 132. And what we're going to talk about today is not just going to be Psalm 132. We're going to read Psalm 132 today, and then tomorrow we're going to tie the passages actually in for the context of 132. We're actually going to look at David and Solomon's life according to this word that's spoken in the Psalms. But for today, I want to give some backstory on why this is so powerful. So when I am walking out my purpose in life, I'm going to use my personal example, because what I'm going to read to you today is something that the Lord spoke to me a couple weeks ago. So the first thing I want to talk about is sowing the word in your heart and being rooted in the word. and I mentioned this when we first started in 1 Kings 17, is that it's not just the call of God. When God speaks something over your life, you have to have an anchor point. And that anchor point is in the Word of God. So yes, you receiving a word from God is the Word of God, but we're talking about a specific anchor point in the Bible according to the Word of God. So, and when you find this anchor point, it allows you to root your faith in it. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God, Romans 10, 17. That faith or connection to God is rooted in the fact that you know God's Word. And when you have a word from God, you can anchor point your life there. Now, I'm going to give a couple examples. Kenneth Hagin was anchored in Mark 11, 23. He used to say, I could never open the Bible without seeing Mark 11, 23. If you know Kenneth Copeland, 1 John 5, 4, I believe, this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith, is that word. You know, there's many great pioneers of faith where God had an anchor point of a word. He had this word that would root them and anchor them. When Dr. Summerall was going into the ministry, and when God called him, the very first word he gave Dr. Summerall was Isaiah 41:10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Funny enough, that word in Isaiah 41:10 was the verse that God gave me when I was a child. When I was a small child, that is the verse that God rooted to where I never lost confidence in the Lord. Now, I didn't get born again until I was 18, you know, when I was had the consciousness to make the decision. But even when I was a child, I knew that verse in Isaiah 41:10. I could quote that verse since I was 6 years old. I mean, it's wrote in the front of the Bible, my original Bible. Because that's the verse God used in my life to deliver me from fear. I never feared anything because of that. You know, so each of these men and women of God had an anchor point in the Word. And my anchor point is 1 Kings 17, verses 3 and 4. It's the call of God that tells you that the provision of God is where God told you to be. That if you will walk in obedience, you will see the abundant provision of the Lord. And I went to a prayer meeting, and I'm saying all of this to get to this point. I went to a prayer meeting one night, and they were the leader of the prayer meeting said, well, we're going to take a minute so you can hear from God about what God wants you to do in life. Well, I obviously run Blank Slate Ministries. I'm the pastor of this. I don't even like calling myself a pastor. I'm the leader of this ministry. And I plant churches. That's kind of what I do. I teach people how to walk out divine purpose. That's what this ministry is all about. Teaching biblical truth to teach you how to walk out divine purpose. We do deliverance, faith, and the Holy Ghost. That's the three things we do. But I sat there because I'm always willing to hear from the Lord. You know, I already know what my purpose is. I don't need God to speak a purpose to me per se, because I'm in the middle of walking out my divine call from the Lord. So I don't need to know what I'm supposed to do in my life because I'm walking it out currently. But I sat there and I said, Lord, I know what you ordained for my life to be. I mean, I'm walking it out currently with you in faith. I said, but if you have anything to speak to me, I said, I'm willing to listen. If you'll speak to me, I'll listen and give me something to sow into my life. So many great pioneers of faith and great men and women of faith who have taught the word for generations, especially in the Word of Faith movement, talked about faith and confession. Charles Capps, sowing the seed, speaking to the mountain. Kenneth Hagin, you know, Kenneth Copeland, Bill Winston, Andrew Womack, Curry Blake, David Hogan, Dr. Summerall. I mean, these great pioneers of faith all spoke about sowing the Word of God into your life to bring forth the promise of God into your life. And so as I was praying, I said, Lord, just speak to me. And the Lord said, Psalm 132. It was absolutely clear. But that's the word he gave me. He said, Psalm 132. He said, your promise is in Psalm 132. Now, this was about five weeks ago that I got this word. And this is the first time I'm actually sharing it, but I felt impressed of the Lord that to bring forth the new season of this ministry. We have entered into a new season. I, in my personal life, entered into a new season when I moved. The church has entered into a new season. We're moving in a direction, and we are going to end up in a building very, very soon. I see the promise of God coming to pass, us entering into a building, us moving into the new things that God has ordained this ministry to be. And so God gave me this word, and I want to read it to you today. I want to read all of Psalm 132, and then we're going to focus on something that was specifically said. Because like I said, we're talking about this relentless pursuit of not quitting. And it not being just not quitting, but the relentless pursuit of not quitting is founded in the fact that you have a aim or a direction at the purpose of God in your life, something that God has ordained you to do. Will keep you from quitting if you are relentless about pursuing the purpose of God for your life. So let's read Psalm 132. Lord, remember David and all his afflictions, how he sware unto the Lord and vowed unto the mighty God of Jacob. Surely I will not come into the tabernacle of my house, nor go up into my bed. I will not give sleep to mine eyes or slumber to mine eyelids until I find out a place for the Lord and habitation for the mighty God of Jacob. Lo, we heard of it in Ephrath. We found it in the fields of the wood. We will go into his tabernacles. We will worship at his footstool. Arise, O Lord, into thy rest, thou and the ark of thy strength. Let thy priests be clothed with righteousness, and let thy saints shout for joy. For thy servant David's sake, turn not away the face of thine anointed. The Lord hath sworn in truth unto David, he will not turn from it. Of the fruit of thy body will I set upon thy throne. If thy children will keep my covenant and my testimony, that I shall teach them, their children shall also sit upon thy throne forevermore. For the Lord hath chosen Zion. He hath desired it for his habitation. This is my rest forever. Here will I dwell, for I have desired it. I will abundantly bless her provision. I will satisfy her poor with bread. I will also clothe her priests with salvation, and her saints shall shout aloud for joy. There will I make the horn of David to bud. I have ordained a lamp for mine anointed. His enemies will I clothe with shame, but upon himself shall his crown flourish. This is a song of decrees, and this is a powerful song of decrees. And we're going to look tomorrow at the context in the book of Samuel into the book, I believe, of Kings. Yeah, Samuel into Kings. I believe that's right. When we transition from David to his son Solomon. Because if you remember, David had this relentless pursuit of his life to find a habitation for the Lord. To build a house for God. David was relentless about this pursuit. When the Ark of the Covenant came into the land, David stripped naked and danced before the Lord in front of everybody. I mean, the Bible says that David was a man after God's own heart. He was in love with the Lord. And his heart was given to God. But not just was his heart given to God, because so many people in the body of Christ today say, well, I love the Lord, but there's no spirit of obedience. I love Mike Bickle said it. He said, loving God does not mean, you cannot love God without a spirit of obedience, a walking in what God's commandments say. They cannot be separate. They have to be together. But one of the things I see is also in the aspect of loving God, David being a man after God's own heart, was this desire on the inside of him, this purpose of his life to build a tabernacle for God. And these first couple verses, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's read the first 5 verses again. Lord, remember David and all his afflictions, all the things that David went through, how he swore unto the Lord and vowed unto the mighty God of Jacob. Surely I will not come into the tabernacle of my house, nor go up into my bed. I will not give sleep to mine eyes or slumber to mine eyelids until I find out a place for the Lord, an habitation for the mighty God of Jacob. That David made this confession and he vowed a vow. He swore unto God, I will not give rest until I find a place to put God. Until I find a house, a habitation for the Lord. I will not rest until that moment. And I love this because this became not just a purpose, not just a call, but a relentless pursuit. David was giving his life over to fulfilling the plan and purpose of God and receiving a temple for God. So I'm at this prayer meeting and I pray. I already know what my purpose in life is. I'm walking it out currently. I'm here in Chicago. I know what my purpose is. I've talked about it many times in our teachings. And when I said, Lord, if there's anything you want to speak to me about what you want from me or what I'm doing or any of those things, I said, just speak to me. And the Lord spoke this passage, Psalm 132. Because if you know what we're going through right now, church, we do not have a habitation for the Lord for this ministry. We're running this entire ministry online. You know, we've been running this ministry online for over a year, and it's been wonderful. You know, we wrote 4 curriculums last year. We got lots of people supporting the ministry. We do daily teachings every day, Sunday services. We teach 3. I mean, we got a lot going on. And not just the things we've done. I've seen a lot of souls come into the kingdom, a lot of deliverance, lots of healings. I mean, mighty power and manifestations of God. And the greatest of all miracles, I've seen myself grow in the Lord. You know, I've seen God do mighty things in my life personally. And so when I seek God and I say, God, what do you want to speak to me? And he gives me this passage. He's saying it's not just you not quitting. He said it is the relentless pursuit of a habitation for God, a house of the Lord. And if you know anything about this ministry, we've been believing God for over a year now for a building at 4646 South Drexel Boulevard, Chicago, Illinois, 60653. Because that blue building, I saw in a prophetic, open-eyed vision before I ever moved to Chicago, a week before I ever moved here. Not when I moved here, before I moved here. I have not, when I received that vision, I had not set foot in Chicago for 6 years. There's no way I could know anything about this building. And this building was only built 2 years before that. So even when I came 6 years before that, that building wasn't even there. So there's no way I would have ever in the natural sense known about this building. But God showed me a prophetic vision, showed me the building. I told 3 different pastors and like 5 other people, 6 other people. I told almost 10 people, I believe, about this building. And you could ask any of those pastors. I described it clearly. Blue, floor to ceiling windows, bars on the windows across. I mean, I described exactly the location. It's in the south side. It's in this. I mean, I knew exactly the area in which God was directing me to be in the south side. And I'd seen the building. And 3 weeks after I moved here, I found it. I found it. It's that 4646 South Drexel. It's the exact building I saw in a prophetic dream or prophetic open-eyed vision a week before I moved here. So the Lord gives me this verse at this prayer meeting. And he says, sow this word. When this right here, when you sow this word, Psalm 132, you're anchored in Chicago in 1 Kings 17:3 and 4. That's the anchor point of my life and my ministry. But to bring forth the next thing, the next season of our ministry, to bring forth our building that we need, the building we've been believing God for, the building that has sat empty ever since I saw it. When I laid my eyes on it and declared it, the Lord said, nobody will set foot in that building except for you. I have declared it yours. And nobody has set foot. They've tried to rent that building out 5 times since I've been here, and every time it falls apart. Because God has ordained it for me, and God has promised it to me. It will never be touched by anybody other than me. And God said, when this word, when you sow this word, you will bring forth out of yourself that building. And nothing can stop this. Nothing can stop. Somebody holding my money, as people would say, cannot happen. This money, this building will be paid in full, and it will come forth because of this word. Because I am relentless about not quitting and seeing the purpose of God come to pass in my life. And we're out of time today. So Father, I thank you. I pray you bless everybody under the sound of my voice. God, let this come alive as we learn to be relentless about seeing your purpose for our life come to pass. As we are relentless about not quitting. As we seek to see your glory come to pass in our life. God, we love you and we thank you for all that you're doing. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. Amen and amen. Church, I love you. Have a wonderful day today. We will see you tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. If you are in our discipleship class, we have class tonight at 7 p.m. We are in topic number 6, knowing God's voice. Listen, do not miss that lesson. That is one of the most important of all 23. So do not miss class tonight. Church, I love you. We'll see you tomorrow.
I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all